These are not assertions. What we're giving you are facts and conclusions based on solid intelligence.
Our intelligence community has carefully reviewed and re-reviewed information regarding this attack. And I will tell you, it has done so more than mindful of the Iraq experience. We will not repeat that moment.
And that experience hangs over all this. 10 years ago, Secretary of State Powell at the United Nations making that case for a strike against Iraq. Secretary Kerry taking the lead right now. Let's talk about this now on our Powerhouse Roundtable. I'm joined by Democratic strategist James Carville, Republican strategist Mary Madeline, Wall Street Journal columnist Peggy Noonan, and Tavis Smiley, radio and television host. And Peggy, let me begin with you. This was a surprise from the president. All the signals were that he was not going to go to the Congress. Apparently, he made this decision mostly on his own. Is it the sign of strength that the president says it is?
Oh, I think everybody pretty much views it as the president blinked. He was in a difficult position. He'd painted himself into a bit of a line with the red line comments. I think he saw the polls and realized he didn't have the people. I think he was hearing Congress start to complain and say, excuse us, you have to consult with us. So in a way, he turned the tables at the end and he said, okay, Congress, you want us to consult? We'll consult with you. So he's sort of going to co-share a certain amount, perhaps, of the responsibility or the blame. I think that's what's happening.
You know, right after he made the decision, his former advisor, David Axelrod, put out a tweet saying this is a big move by POTUS, consistent with his principles. Congress is now the dog that caught the car. He thinks he is trying to turn the tables on him. But is that the case, James Carville?
I think a little bit, and I think that they didn't have the support. The horror of Iraq still lingers over not just the United States and the world. This will force attention. They'll force them to bring the evidence. It'll force the Congress. All in all, you know, I think it's probably a pretty good thing to do. But, George, this is hurricane season. Look at the Category 5s that are headed to Washington. You have this vote. You have the appropriations that are coming up to fund the government. You have the debt ceiling vote. You may have a Fed chair vote here in the next 6 weeks or so. This is a really intense time. We're back here 2-3 months from now. The change, the tenor of American politics could easily change with 4 votes of this size.
And I want to get to that, and that raises the stakes, Mary Madeline, for the president. Now that he's gone to Congress, he's got to win this.
Yes and no. If he doesn't, I'm sure he'll blame the Republicans for being obstructionists, as he always does. The reason he's going to Congress is because he had to. There's no public support. There's no congressional support. Public support is, what, 20%, 80% are against it. Martha said war-weary, war-wise. They're foreign policy flummoxed. I've been out there. And in this case, what is the objective to punish? What is the trigger? Because he poisoned before. Is it the number or is it the act of poisoning? What is the exit strategy? None of these questions are answered. And Congress is in their district, and left and right, and Democrats and Republicans, and there's nobody out there that's saying, other than John McCain and the Hawks, saying, go, go, go.
Well, and that could mean, Tavis, when the president gets caught in a pincer movement. You've got John McCain and Lindsey Graham saying, no, it's got to be a much more robust response. A lot of Democrats saying, we don't want to go in at all.
I think you're right about that. And I think Peggy's right about the fact that you don't draw a line, red or otherwise, and then dare somebody to cross it and then call that diplomacy. In my neighborhood, we call that playing a game of chicken. When you lose the game of chicken, you got to be prepared to do something. I think James is right as well, that every time the president wants to turn the conversation to the economy, that's what we ought to be talking about. Either he does something or something beyond his control happens that changes the conversation. But at the risk of being the odd man out, let me just add some broader context just very quickly, George. Just days ago, we were celebrating 50 years since the March on Washington. And President Obama stood where Dr. King stood 50 years ago. And we honored Martin with our words in Washington. And now here we are days away from dishonoring him with our deeds in Syria. There is another side. There's another side to this. It's the issue of violence. War, Dr. King would say, were he here, is not the answer. We cannot worship at the altar of retaliation, Dr. King would say, were he here. It's either nonviolent coexistence or violent co-annihilation, Dr. King would say, were he here. The only point I'm making here is that we can't, just like this is connected to Iraq, it's connected to all of our history. And we can't honor the man with our words and then dishonor him days later with our deeds.
Let me challenge that a little bit and bring it to Peggy Noonan. That tends to work in a civil society that recognizes some norms. How do you do that with a dictator, Peggy Noonan, who we've all seen the evidence. We've all seen the people who were struggling to breathe after being gassed.
Yeah, this is one of the things I think whatever people decide about America should intervene in Syria, America should not, we should send in the Tomahawks, we shouldn't. That is a military argument. We shouldn't lose sight of the essential and important moral one, which is that Assad of Syria has, in public, in the YouTube generation, with little pro forma denials, but in front of the world, gassed his own people. That means the world, which knows it happened, is sort of standing at a doorway where you go forward into darkness or not. If the world says to Assad, it's okay, gas your own people, kill more than 400 babies, you are not going to get less chemical warfare in the future. You're going to get more of it. You're going to get biological. You are going to get nuclear. This is apart from any military argument. What I mean is the moral fact is something we can't forget or get around.
I totally agree.
We have to deal with.
I totally agree. That's the point I'm trying to make. There isn't just a political issue here. There is a moral issue here. And where the morality is concerned, why is it that the only way to respond to this is with more violence? Again, I go back to King. It's either nonviolent coexistence or violent co-annihilation. And I just don't think that that violence is the only answer to this crisis.
Yeah, I think that if we'll frame our response this way, we're not intervening in Syria. We're punishing Assad. Because Assad is the one that actually did this. And this is a horrible thing to gas young people. Let's just put that right out. I don't think Dr. King would have approved of that at all.
Not at all.
And I think if it's framed like that, I think you're going to get a lot more support. And the morality of the case is really good. Because, if you try to intervene in Syria, people will say you're trying to unscramble
eggs.
But
that limited frame is what loses Mary Madeline.
The shot over the bow, the limited strike. This is a region that doesn't go for nuance. They hardly respond to any kind of deterrence. They're out there bragging that the president has pulled back, the president has changed his mind. But there is a political and a moral element, and they're not inextricable. If this is immoral, how is this more immoral than raping and killing Christians in Egypt? Like, what is our trigger for responding to humane atrocity?
Weapons of mass destruction are different, Mary, aren't they?
I think raping young girls and murdering Christians is a pretty... Our first principle, if we're standing on principle, is religious freedom. And we're not we're not even saying anything about that.
That's where the red line comes in. Once you draw that line, and dare somebody to cross it, and they do. You have to be prepared to do something. But when all hell breaks loose in this region, George, then what are we going to do? We can talk about the military solution all we want. I will not back down this particular point. This is a moral question, and what King is getting us to look at is a revolution of values. If we don't change our values,
are you arguing that this is going to be that yours is an effective strategy, or that we should just be sort of stay pure and stay out of it?
No, I'm not. The argument is not that something ought not be done. The argument is that we have to find a diplomatic solution to this, and I don't know why violence is always the first and only answer to every problem. We have mass doses of violence do not solve our problems.
Look, we know they used them twice before, and we sent them strong warnings.
And we did nothing.
But now they at a point they said, okay, this is it. But and by the way, the use of chemical weapons is banned in warfare. We horror at the use of them. The Germans didn't use them. The Japanese didn't use them. The North Koreans didn't use them. I mean, there's some really immoral line that's been crossed here.
Yeah, but it used to be, people used to be a little more careful to do it secretly, quietly, and the world didn't find out in real time. They only found out later. This was the real time telling of the world, we're doing this terrible thing. Look, part of what we're talking about here, part of the paralysis in Washington, if that's the right word, is due to the fact that 10 years ago, let me put it a different way, we are not united and moving militarily against a country that we know has used weapons of mass destruction. Because 10 years ago, we moved militarily against a country that turned out not to have weapons of mass destruction. This is about the past 10 years.
But that same 10 years ago, Saddam had knowingly, over close to a dozen times, used chemical weapons. In this case, we know that Assad used chemical weapons. It just did it quietly. And in this case also, we had some allies in Iraq, close to 50, and we had some support on the ground. Secretary Kerry said this morning we're depending on others to fight this. Well, those others are not only disparate, there's some reports that we had intelligence that this strike of this magnitude was coming 3 days ahead, and we didn't tell anybody. We let babies and mothers die in their beds.
But 10 years later, they are laughing at us. George reported this earlier. They're laughing at us in the Middle East. They don't believe us now because
they're laughing at us because we're not striking. You don't want us to strike.
Yeah. But I'm going to my second point, though.
They're taunting us.
That's my point. They're taunting us, and we're playing into their hands. That's the point I was about to make. They're taunting us. They're laughing at us. We're playing into their hands, and they don't believe us now because 10 years ago, we didn't give them the truth.
You know, 50 years from now, when my grandchildren are studying, or great-grandchildren are studying American history, they will learn that the impact and the ramifications of the Iraq War were longer-lasting and more profound than the Vietnam War. Both around the world and here in the United States. This war, and Peggy's right, this thing just rings in everybody's ear all around the world.
And that is going to have to be the last word today. Thank you all very much. Before we do go, though, I do want to remember, we just learned this morning that David Frost, the veteran broadcaster of the BBC, 74 years old, has died of a heart attack. And, of course, we all remember that unforgettable interview he did many years ago with Richard Nixon. Take a look.
There are certain situations where the president can decide that it's in the best interest of the nation or something and do something illegal.
Well, when the president does it, that means that it is not illegal.
By definition.
Exactly.
When does something like that happen in an interview, Peggy Noonan?
Wow, that was the greatest explanation. It was a window into the mind of Richard Nixon and an explanation for Watergate. All won by an innocent-seeming, jolly, let's go out and have a few beers, British journalist who made people feel comfortable and with ingenuous curiosity made you say things you had not planned on saying. He was great.
Absolutely brilliant. Thank you all for your contributions this morning. We'll be right back.